too long.
Bye.
end of the day. They tell me that next week is December 25th, if we live. And I'm sure that those of us that are store bound have been bound. In preparation of this festive and blessed time in the calendar, particularly of the United States, but not just the United States, but all over the world, Christians are especially commemorating or remembering the birth of our Lord, our Savior, Jesus Christ. And along this time of year, what happens in so many instances in churches is that the preaching arm of the church, no doubt, as we have been the last couple of Sundays, making an effort to speak from that aspect of scripture that regarding and surrounding the birth of our Lord. And it's a good thing for the church to have understanding of why we do what we do. Whenever the church is doing anything. And before I need to get this preliminary, I need to get this. On behalf of the men that shared this platform with me, from the matriarchs of our church family, from the official staff of this church, I just want to say that it's good to see each and every one of you today. And we'd like to take this particular time, and I know that so many of you were a part of what we had as a little fellowship time during the worship, right? Shaking hands, kissing babies, and the like. But we take this time also to say, especially from the leadership of the church, to extend this time to our friends, to our enemies, to our neighbors, family, both far and near. We just want to take this time to say that you're welcome here to share in this effort of worship that we. We try to cover just Lottie, Dottie, Daddy's, just everybody. You are welcome here. All righty. This is a phrase was coined some years ago. Jesus is the reason. Say it one more again. Jesus is the reason. That got coined some years ago and was kind of a catchy thing that folks say Jesus is the reason for the season. If you ask so many folk, for what reason do you do the season? I think that you would get quite a few different answers. I pray God that we are getting better understanding of the circumstances and issues surrounding our Lord's birth. And I don't want to bore you, so I'm going to take you to, and I'm talking about with the scripture. We're going to go out of the second chapter, again, of Matthew. And I pray to highlight some details. To give you some things to chew on that maybe you really hadn't just thought about before. That's the effort, at least it is for me, in reviewing some of these details. And we've kind of talked about a great deal the fact that there were This is, of course, after Jesus' birth. Jesus has been born already. And a lot of people still right today don't realize that the wise men, the magi, did not come to the manger. Okay, there were no, the magi did not find Jesus at a manger. When the magi came, Jesus was, and this is approximated, Jesus was about 2 years old then. And when these wise men, and they are called wise men, what is translated wise men is taken from a Greek word, magi. The Greek word magi is where we get what is translated here, wise men. And given that that's how magi is translated, I'm going to make an effort here to deal with that particular thing. What is it that makes a man wise? The Magi, talked a little bit about it. The Magi were, we don't know all of the nations that they came from, Persia, Arabia, India. Don't know exactly. But what made them who they were in their homeland was the fact that they were given this description, this title, because of the knowledge that they had. It is believed that the Magi were great in mathematics and astrology and the science, as it were, of their day. So they were considered wise men because of what they knew. Do y'all hear me? So then, when they come to Jesus, when they come looking for Jesus, they do not come looking for him empty-handed. Is that right? Y'all help me, please. Help me. Okay. When they come to Jesus, we don't know how many there were, but what is enumerated in the Bible are these three things: gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Is that right? What was the last thing? Right, that's what it said. Now, when they leave their homeland, they leave their homeland in search of a king.
Right.
Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Amen just means I agree.
Right.
Okay?
Right.
That's all it means. Nothing super, super deep, long. So then, they leave their homeland, and now, have you ever thought about who told them that who they were looking for was a king? You ever thought about it? Most of you know.
No.
Most of you know. But for some reason, and it's not given by text, so it's kind of speculative on my part, speculation on my part, but just understand, they left their homeland, be it India, China, Arabia, but when they left, they did not leave empty-handed, and they had some knowledge about themselves. What's this? About how things are done in their land. Okay? So what is it coming to? Look at this. Whenever in their homeland, whenever they would go to pay tribute to a king, they always brought something of their homeland that was valued there. You get what I'm saying?
Okay.
It was valued in their homeland, and they would bring it to this king to pay tribute, to pay homage to this king. And so, when they left their homeland,
of this king doing any great exploits. The only thing that they knew is that they were going to look for a king. Now, mind you, who told them that they would find him? Who told them that they would, in fact, find him in order to get them gifts? And so now, here, I want you to really think about these men, because there was nothing that said that they would actually find the king. But they left anyway, didn't they? They left because of the knowledge that they had, that the king was to be born, and there was that within them that said it's going to happen. They get to Jerusalem, and they go to Herod's place. Y'all remember they went to Herod's place? They followed the light, the star, and it was the star that led them finally to Christ. And now, imagine how they might have felt. And I don't know how come none of the gospel writers really talk about this in great detail, but now, the issue is kind of here in the text, because now look at what they brought. They brought gold, frankincense, myrrh, valuable stuff. The reason that they went to Herod's place was because if there's a king gonna be born, a king ought to be born at the palace. They didn't know whether it was gonna be Herod's son or some descendant of the then king. You know what I'm saying? But now, the first place that they went, when they got to Jerusalem and the light to inquire of a king. Where is he that is born king of the Jews? They left with the knowledge that they had from their homeland. They pressed their way in. When they get to Jesus, they don't find Jesus in a palace. Right?
Right.
When they find Jesus, now, Augustus Caesar had put out an edict, a mandate, that he was going to have a census of the people. So Jerusalem and surrounding areas, it was packed out with folk. Because in order to be numbered or to take part in the census, you would go to the birth of your family. The place of the birth of your family. So Bethlehem, Jerusalem, surrounding that, it was packed out from folk coming in from all over Palestine, all over the place. They were coming to the places of their family's birth. And so when they get to Bethlehem is packed out, and they find the king up here in Centralia. What's y'all's
project?
No. What's moving on up to the east side over here? One of your better neighborhoods, better subdivisions than the like. Wait a minute, y'all from Centralia said,
Clearly.
Clearly. Wait. They don't find Jesus in Clear Lake.
All right.
The wise men are looking for Christ, and the star, the light that they were following, passed up Clear Lake and winds up in
what y'all call me, like
project.
Yeah.
following the light, following the star, passing, wait a minute, it seems like we ought to be stopping over here at a clear light, looking for a king.
Yes.
So listen, what does that say? That God's mind and your mind is not the same mind.
Right.
For what made Jesus king was not where he lived.
Yeah.
See, that? That's why we got a jackpot. If we live in the Ritzy neighborhood, if we drive the Benzo and the they found him in a humble house.
Yes.
And the Bible doesn't mention his daddy. When the Magi found him, they found he and his mother. And look at what they did. When they got to the housing project, they knelt down and worship.
Yes.
Does it take a particular kind of place for you to worship God? And listen, this is just my imagination. Those men had to be scratching their heads as they passed the palace, they passed the building, and they wound up down in the projects, and then and the word got to them all the way in Persia, in India, in Arabia, that a marvelous great king is going to be born. And then when they finally get to this marvelous, awesome king, they say, huh? But it didn't stop them. Jesus may not be the your picture of what a king ought to be.
Right, sir.
But that's because you are not looking at him with the right eye.
Right.
For here's the thing. It still didn't stop them. When they got there, they saw the little fella standing there with his mother.
Yeah.
And when they put the gold, the incense, and myrrh at his feet, and they bowed down.
Yes.
And they prostrate themselves before a king. Now watch this. They prostrate themselves. This is speculation on my part. This is eisegesis. Yeah. Watch this though. Think that they had ever worshipped a king. Not only did they give homage by giving their gold, they worshipped. Now here's the thing.
lions when they found Jesus where they found him. And Herod had told them to come back and report to him when they had found him. Is that right? Now, guess who heard, guess who also heard Herod tell them to come back? God. Herod says, come back and tell me when you found him so I can come and worship him also. Now me, as they were riding along, I think they might say, isn't it kind of peculiar that we know about this king and Herod don't know? Mm-hmm. Y'all hear me?
Right.
Don't you think it's kind of strange that we're not even from around here and we got the word? See, it doesn't matter where you are. If Christ is going to get the word to you,
yes,
he's going to use somebody.
Right, sir.
Yeah. He's going to use somebody to get the information to you.
Right.
Okay.
So that you can come and see.
Yes.
For yourself.
Yeah.
See now. Of the one that's on that camel.
Right.
show me your way.
Yes.
Show me your will. And what they brought, listen to me, they brought what they understood that would please a king. But see now, they were mistaken. Jesus didn't want their gold. But what they brought gave a witness that he was king.
Yeah! you, Jesus. Oh, my God. My God.
I really can't explain how come I keep on riding. But there is a still small voice speaking to my sanctified soul. Back from giving him my pain.
Yes.
He gives me his peace.
Yes.
That's why I brought him.
Thank you. Thank you, Lord.
And sometimes I can remember when I brought him my pain.
Yeah.
It seemed like it was a little while.
Pain
was gone. And then there were other times, when I brought in my pain. And I feel real good because I knew everything was going to be all right because I remember what he did last time. Watch this. But then the same amount of time passed. And I still was hurting a little bit. I was waving at him. I mean, the last time when I brought you my pain, your text is just chop. But now, I just want you to know, I didn't pick it back up, though. You didn't have enough in the basket. All of that stuff that I was taking there, putting it in his hands, casting my cares on, he didn't tell me to stop casting.
Right.
For deliverance is his business.
Yes.
Do y'all hear me?
Yes.
Don't tell God that this is too much. For he has promised that you'll never get too much that cannot be handled.
Yes.
He will not put more on you
yes.
than what you can bear. For every instance of trouble, be it from the inside or from the outside, it is a test.
Yes.
And listen, I was talking to some ministers yesterday, because you know, one of the brothers, he teaches folk that that God tested Abraham to see what Abraham would do. That ain't true. There was two people, actually there were three people there, and only one of them knew what the outcome was going to be.
Right.
Abraham was there, Isaac was there, and God was there. Well now, one of those three knew already how that situation was going to come out. But Abraham didn't know. Isaac didn't know. So the test was not to prove Abraham to God. It was to prove Abraham to Abraham.
Right.
That's fine. When I was teaching in college, I didn't test the students to see what I knew.
Right, sir. Right, sir.
Luxurious things, you may pass them right up.
Yes,
but it really doesn't matter where you find the pearl of great price.
Right. Yes.
Right.
Thank you. Thank you.
We've got some good news.
Thank you.
God is still looking for wise men. Be a wise man and make some folk wise.
Yes.
When did they get wise? They actually were the wise men when they bowed before wisdom. Beginning to see the Lord, the Bible says, is the beginning of wisdom. And the knowledge of God is understanding.
Yeah, that's right. Mm-hmm.
We find that in Proverbs chapter 9. So then, do you know the Lord? Without knowing him, you really don't have the proper understanding.
Right.
Without knowing him, you really don't have the wisdom for deliverance. You read the ninth chapter of Proverbs. Man, this is some pretty terrible stuff in there. But some awesome things about a wise man.
Amen.
Everybody all right?
Yeah.
Got a little bit to chew on, do you?
No.
Got to chew now? Got you now?
No.
See, some folk like to put stuff in their mouth and just swallow. Yes. Now, my mother, I'm going to let you know. My mother showed me how to, see, most people don't know how to eat chicken. Man, my mother showed me how, by the time I get through with a piece of chicken, ain't even no moisture on the bone. Bone be hard as a rock, petrified. I used to tell my son, man, if you see all that meat you leave on that bone, are you crazy? When it comes to the bread of God, eat the whole loaf. Yeah, my mother said, "Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good and His mercy." I think I recognize most every face in here, but this is the time when I would extend an invitation. I don't know your heart, but if the Lord, by His power, by His Spirit, the Lord has stirred your heart, your mind, won't you come?
My name is Isaac Parker, and pastor of the Second Baptist Church in Centralia, Illinois. Myself and my wife Linda, just wanted to take some time to say to our church family at large, to the Second Baptist Church family at large, we pray that God would bless in this time of celebration of the birth of our Lord and our Savior. We pray that it would be a time of a fellowship with family and friends as you do, again, commemorate the birth of our Lord and our Savior. Once again, God bless you. Have a safe and festive Christmas season.
Merry Christmas.